As an assistant professor in MET Maritime University in the Nautical Science Department. I'm going to give you a small briefing on the carriage of dangerous goods at sea in packaged forms, which basically means containers. There has been number of casualties like major fires due to lack of knowledge of carriage of such dangerous goods on containers. So you must have brief outline knowledge of carriage of dangerous goods on container ships. Basically there are two volumes, one supplement, and the contents is quite vast. Even to do a course, it will take you a number of days. So here I am going to put it to you very briefly in a short lecture. But if you want to specialize, you have to do a course on this IMDG cargoes. That applies to both shippers, that is those who give the cargo to the ship, and the carriers, that is those who work on the ship. It applies to both, right. So let's start with this code book. A safe carriage, stowage and carriage, you must refer to this book by IMO, which is called IMDG code, right. It's you can get a soft copy or a hard copy, both. Next. So since containerization came, there has been a lot of increase in dangerous goods at sea, and this is basically because there is a lot of freight in DG cargoes, and therefore a ship owner will try to always carry this cargo at sea. There is a lot of requirements, how it must be packed, stowed and carried on ship, and also the lack of care taken, and what documentation is required. Without document, it's difficult to later on justify anything. So what documents are required when carrying dangerous cargoes, right. Next. Ready? Return this side? No. Okay. So if you are not careful, this is what can happen on the ship. See, here it clearly shows that they have not followed the requirements of this important code, IMDG code, and this is a type of fire they had faced in the middle of the sea, probably even resulted in loss of life. And this is, you can see here, ship which has got a container carrying this IMDG cargo and how it has caught fire at sea, right. And so this is a major marine casualty at sea. What makes it compulsory, mandatory? This is given in SOLAS, that is Safety of Life at Sea, which is a publication, as well as MARPOL, that is Convention which to prevent marine pollution at sea, right. And therefore, through these both these conventions, they made it mandatory for all ships to follow this code book, whenever they are carrying these dangerous cargoes in containers on board ship. Now, if you are carrying dangerous cargo in bulk, you have to refer to another code which is called IMSBC code, right? International Maritime Code for Carriage of Dangerous Cargoes in IMSBC code, right? Now, what is the contents? This contents two volumes and one supplement. If you go through all this, it gives you a brief guideline on how to carry dangerous goods safely on ship. Right, volume 1, what it contains. You have definitions, what sort of training. There are so many dangerous cargoes in this world, how they can be classified. Basically, classified into 9 divisions. How do you pack these cargoes? What kind of tanks? And then put them on the ship. How do you construct these packings or special containers meant to carry these dangerous cargoes? They may be tanks, or they can even be coming by road, by tank vehicles. How should they be constructed and tested? How they are to be transported? See, these are some of the things which you have to study very carefully in volume 1, right? Next, volume 2. Next, volume 2, what does that discuss? It gives a list of all dangerous goods which are carried in the world, a complete list. And there is another column for limited and quantities accepted, right? That means certain dangerous goods you can only carry in limited quantities, like explosives on passenger ships, so that the degree of danger can be kept under control, or accepted quantities. That means if you carry it in package form, more put into packets, smaller packet, in even smaller packet, then pack it carefully. The code says we will give you some liberty to stow it in a more easier manner, right? And that is why, because cargoes need to be segregated. If I carry two dangerous cargoes, I must first check up whether both can be kept together or how close they can be kept together. That is called segregation, and you have to segregate these cargoes. Otherwise, if they react with each other, they can become very dangerous. Right. And then you got an index where you can refer, an appendices which gives you more details on specific topics. Right, now we go on to very important part of the code, which is a supplement. Right. Now, this supplement will tell you what to do if there is an emergency with this cargo, such as a fire, spillage. It will also give you a guidebook called Medical First Aid Guide. Because on the ship you have no doctor, then you have to, what to do, open this medical first aid guide and see if this cargo, this kind of incident took place. Say somebody's hand has got burnt, what do I do? It will give you guidance temporarily what you can do till you get medical assistance. Then if this dangerous cargo falls into the sea, say one container full of IMDG dangerous cargo fell into the sea, it's going to harm environment, people using the beach. You have to warn them. How do you warn them? You report. Whom do you report? How to report? You're on the ship, which is the nearest place you can report, which authority you can report. This is given in reporting procedures. And then in these transport unit, how you pack them safely. Pesticides. You know what are pesticides? An infamous incident took place when pesticide leaked in a factory, which is called Bhopal gas tragedy. It happened some time back. In Bhopal, there was a company manufacturing pesticides, and one fine day there was leakage in the factory. It left almost 3,000 people dead. And there was a long battle fighting for compensation and so on. This is known as Bhopal gas tragedy, which was basically caused because of pesticide leak. You know what are pesticides? You spray them to kill insects and that kind of thing where pests are there. Those are called pesticides. So these are now considered very harmful. When you use pesticides, they will use it with the cargo so that cargo doesn't get harmed during the voyage. If you don't do it carefully, this can be harmful to people involved. So there's a separate topic, safe use of pesticides. Irradiated nuclear fuel is the last topic, which talks. Some people, what they do is they carry it on any ship, the nuclear materials which are used. Of course, they are used for good purposes, maybe for medicinal use or reactors for producing energy. But the waste which is left, you can't dump it anywhere. You have to carry it on special ships meant for carrying irradiated nuclear fuel. So this has got two classes of ship, which discusses which type of ship you will carry, what quantity, where you deliver it. Otherwise, you can't dump it into the sea, then it's harmful to environment. Right? This is discussed in the INF code, irradiated nuclear fuel, which is now made mandatory through this supplement. So basically, all the dangerous goods, they divide them into 9 classes, right? You can't just say it is one class. For example, it starts with the most dangerous. Your class 1 is explosives. Then it comes down, 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 goes to last one, class 9, miscellaneous substance. So the most dangerous is given class 1, right? You can see class 6 is better than explosives. So it is given infectious substance, depending on their physical and chemical properties. Right? All dangerous cargoes, you have to have a label on them. You can't just carry it and go. People, without seeing anything, at least if they see the label, they can recognize what sort of dangerous cargo is it, right? What classes belong to, how dangerous it is. So they'll put labels on these boxes. Now you can see that basically only numbering is there, because this code itself may be written in other IMO recognized languages, maybe Spanish, Russian or Arabic. So if you read in English, everybody may not know. You should know one thing, that all over the world, it's not that everybody knows English. For example, Japanese may not know, Chinese may not know. So if they see this diagram and the number, they can refer to their own book and make out what kind of dangerous cargo it is. That's the main idea behind labeling these things, right? Sometimes you may think, why to label, why not write there in big block letters? The main reason is that language difficulties may arise, right? So this is called labeling of dangerous or hazardous cargoes IM to IMDG code. Very important is the documentation part. If you don't have documents, do not load the cargo, because in case of any investigation, or it also becomes master has to justify. You simply have to say, sorry, no documents, I won't load the cargo, I will say, right? So what are the documents required? Prior loading, it's a responsibility of the shipper and the master. Shipper is the person who delivers the cargo, and the master should make sure he has these documents. The first one you can see is dangerous goods declaration. Because captain cannot see what is inside, he goes by good faith, and therefore the shipper gives a declaration to the master saying, don't worry, I have packed all this cargo as required by regulations, I have placarded, I have put the label on it, nothing will go wrong, I am declaring it to you. So he gives a declaration to the captain that he has taken care to pack this cargo properly as required by the code. Good. So the captain kicks a copy and says, put the dangerous cargo on the ship. Then you should have a certificate which should say what is inside, what dangerous cargo complete list. This is stuck outside, also captain will have a copy, and this is called a packing certificate, right. Apart from these two certificates, what else is required? Now, what does this declaration exactly contain given by the shipper, right? It will give details. What is the proper shipping name? You can't give any name which you like. What is the number allotted by United Nations? United Nations allotted number for each dangerous cargo. Which class of hazard it is from 1 to 9? Is it explosive? Right? Is it infectious? It's chemical. Then subsidiary risk, that means has it got only one risk or more than one risk? It may have some other risk as well. Packaging group, how do I package this cargo? Basically falls into three groups, group 1, group 2 and group 3. Which group it is packed, how many number of packages I am giving to you, what is its weight, is it also a marine pollutant or only dangerous? Dangerous is one thing, it can cause fire or explosion on ship. If it is a marine pollutant, if it falls into the sea, it can harm environment, right. Any other chemical properties, this is what he declares, gives it to the master, which is called declaration. Now, there are two things basically they are concerned about in the code. One is called stowage and another is called segregation. Stowage is basically where do you place it on the ship, and segregation is basically if I have two dangerous cargoes, how far I have to place them from each other. So, for stowage, they are divided into categories, both for cargo ship and for passenger ships. And it basically says, where do you store? Do you keep it on deck or under the deck of the ship, or don't store it anywhere at all, right? That is called the stowage part. And then there is the segregation part, which says that if I carry these two dangerous cargoes, how far apart they must be kept, segregated from each other. Such a table exists separately for container ships, roll-on roll-off ships, lash ships and general cargo ships. Basically they are same, but you must consult each time when you are loading each type of cargoes. So, to sum up, you have to know where to store the cargo and how to segregate dangerous cargoes on the ship, right. Next, as I said, these will be allotted categories. If I have the cargo, I must see, does it belong to 1 to 15, right. Now, for passenger ships and cargo ships, the tables are different. The 0 to 1, A to E are just numbers and letters. So, each cargo is given depending on cargo ship or passenger ship. By referring to this, again as I said, you can make out whether you can carry on deck or under deck or only on deck or totally are prohibited from carrying these cargoes. This is what I mean by segregation. Right. Segregation is different for container ships, ro-ros, general cargoes. By referring to these tables, you can make out how far apart I must keep two dangerous cargoes. If I am carrying only one dangerous cargo, obviously this table does not apply. Normal carriage, just refer to stowage only. But if I am carrying two dangerous cargoes, I must refer to both stowage and segregation tables, right. Remember that there are segregation tables different for container ships, ro-ro ships, general cargo ships, lash ships. So, I must refer to all these four separately, right. This is a table of segregation. When I refer when I am carrying ro-ro ships, right, on roll-on roll-offs, so you will find it in the code book. Very important is Very important is this emergency procedures, EMS, which I said is given in supplement. What does this book give? There can be two kinds of emergencies, either a fire or spillage. If there is a fire, open this book, see against a number, United Nations number and shipping name. What should I do when such a fire takes place, right? Second, if there is a spillage of the cargo on deck, open this book, see which cargo, what number, what shipping name, etc., etc. This is the action to take. That's basically what EMS guide is, emergency schedule, right. So, these are given in code forms in emergency. For fire, it will be given in F, A to J, refer which one applies depending on cargo. You will already get it from volume 1 that which one applies, which letter I should check. Similarly, for spillage, look up this, simply follow the guidelines. And the medical first aid guide, also given as part of supplement. What does that tell you, right? It has got a flow chart. What is the symptoms you are having? This. If you have this, next, what is the procedure to follow? Then yes or no. Are you all right here? Not all right. Yes. Again, next, flow chart. Consult this. This way you can get yourself treated on the ship till you get better medical assistance from shore. So, let's summarize what we did about IMDG code. Number one, it is a mandatory. Whenever you carry dangerous goods in containers, package form, you must follow this code. If you are signatory to SOLAS, which almost all maritime countries are, you have to follow this. The shipper, that is one who puts cargo on board, right? It is his responsibility to pack the cargo and deliver it to the master. Also give a document to the master he has done so, right? And then, as far as ship is concerned, it is the ship's responsibility to see that you stow this cargo, segregate this cargo carefully on board the ship. Finally, there is an emergency on the ship. What to do? As I told you, open the medical first aid guide, open emergency schedule. So, this is a briefing on IMDG code. Thank you for your listening.